Alright, good morning everyone. Today we continue our review. We'll continue solving questions. I still don't have more details about the final exam. I hope I will have more details on Friday. If I don't, I'll send an email later. For now, I only know that the exam covers all the material that we cover in the course. It emphasizes the material covered after the midterm more than the material covered before the midterm, but still there are really questions for material before the midterm, including one question which we should pulled out of the midterm verbatim. So review your midterm, review all the material before the midterm, and most importantly, review the material and learn the material after the midterm. Number of questions, what kind of questions, all this information is still not finalized, so I don't want to comment on it yet. So today I want to talk about questions which are somewhat similar to questions that appeared on the final 2 years ago. There is only one December final posted online for now. Maybe I'll find some more finals from a for example, but for now there is only one. So the first questions which are inspired by the questions which did appear on the exam. Let's start with the following question. We are given a function defined by cases. It's a times x. If x is smaller than b, it is e to the power square root of x. If x is at least b. And the question is find a and b so that, or that make all points. So once again, before we start discussing the solution, let me give you, I don't know, 3 to 5 minutes to think about it, and if you get stuck, raise your hand, I'll come give you a hint, or if you finish the question, raise your hand, I'll come and see whether you got it right. And then in 5 minutes we'll start discussing it. Thank you. once again, please, if you are stuck at some point, please raise your hand and ask me. It's exactly what I want to get out of this exercise, to get you to a point where you get stuck and push you past this point. It's your learning that you have. So I think I've seen where, like, at what point you tend to get stuck and what steps you are making. So let me discuss this question. I have a function which consists of two parts. And the formulas for two parts suggest that, well, these two parts are actually nice and continuous and differentiable everywhere, at least at the points where they are defined. And the only problem that could possibly happen is at the point where one part gets transitioned to the other part. So maybe the two parts do not match. And what we want is to make the whole function differentiable everywhere, including the point, the transition point, B. So we'll have to be extra careful at this point B. And I think most of you got at least one of the conditions right. That at the point B, the two branches should match. The function should be at least continuous. You should not have a sudden jump in definition of this function. So, solution would involve two conditions. One, continuity at point B. So if I don't want to have a jump in the definition of the function, I better have one part of the function and the other part approach the same value. I can't quite say have the same value. It would be technically a little bit wrong.
because this range is only defined for x which is strictly smaller than b. So I can't really talk about the value of this range and the point b. But I can talk about the limit. So the definition of continuity would be that the limit at this point exists at the point b. So x goes to b. Since here we have different definitions of the functions from the left and from the right, it makes sense to split this condition to two parts. Then the limit from the left exists, limit from the right exists, and they match. So limit from the left of this function is the same as limit from the right of this function. And they also should match the value of the function at the point B, which is e to the power square root of b. So in parentheses, you can say that here I wrote the condition that the limit of the function is the same from left, from right, and matches the value of the function at the point B. That's exactly the condition here. And then I translated the condition without the limits. I can compute this limit. So this limit is just a times b, that limit is e to the power square root of b, and e to the square root of b is already e to the square root of b. So that's one condition. You should be aware of the fact that this is not enough. You only make the function continuous at this point. We might still have continuous functions which are not differentiable. Does anyone remember an example of such a function? Something which is continuous but not differentiable at the point. Yes, so typical example would be something like this. Absolute value of x is continuous everywhere. You don't have to leave the shop of the board to draw the graph. But still, there is a point where the function is not differentiable. The slope of the tangent from the left is not the same as the slope of the tangent from the right. They have two different tangent lines in the range. So second condition would be that the derivatives at the point B match. That would be the limit as x goes to B from the left of the derivative of AX is the same as limit as x goes to B from the right of the derivative of the right part. So as you approach this point from the left, you get one slope of derivative. As you approach it from the right, you get a different slope. Slope of the graph, you get the slope of the tangent line to the graph. You get a different one, and you want them to match. So you want to have the same derivative at this point. Which means we compute these derivatives. 1 over 2 square root of x, e to the square root of x. Here applies the chain. I have e raised to the complicated power, the power which is an expression in terms of x, so I apply the chain. Derivative of e to some power is e to that power. Derivative of square root of x is 1 over twice square root of x. So half x to minus 1. And finally, the second condition is, well, what is this thing? This might be the most confusing part. What is this limit? Just a. So a is a parameter, it does not depend on x. So regardless of how x changes, this thing on the left is just a. The thing on the right will approach as 1 over twice the root of b times e square root of b. So that's the second condition. It makes sure that the derivatives at the point b match. To be honest, there is one third condition, which is more subtle and
doesn't appear that often in these types of questions, but there is a third condition. It kind of comes even before continuity and differentiability. You want this function to be defined everywhere. So maybe a third condition, f is defined everywhere. What kind of condition this gives on a and b, where this function might not be defined? Yes, so the first definition gives you a definition for the function when x is smaller than b for all points. Second branch might pose some problem. If you try to plug in numbers x which are negative, this thing will not be defined. So you only want to plug in numbers which are positive. And the numbers that you do plug in are numbers which are at least b. So if you want numbers which are at least b to be positive, you want to make sure that b is positive. Because otherwise, e to the square root of x might, well, will not be defined. Some x which is still greater than b. If b is negative, you can choose x which is greater than b but still negative, and then e to the square root of x will not be defined. Okay, so this part was only about, well, conceptual stuff. If I want the function to be differentiable everywhere, I want it to be defined everywhere, be continuous everywhere, and differentiable everywhere. So define right here, continuous, the limit from the left, which is the limit from the right, and both match the value at the point. Differentiable means the derivatives of the two branches match at this point B. And finally, define, in this particular case, translated to this condition. Next part is usually just algebra. You have conditions you want to solve for A and B. So next part is, I have these conditions, A, B equal to E to square root of B. A is 1 over twice square root of B, E to square root of B, and B is positive. I want to find what is A, what is B, and check that B is positive. So how do I find what is A, what is B?
Any substitution for two equations?
Yes. So I have two equations on two unknowns. It's usually simpler to solve one equation about one unknown. So I'll try to express one of the variables in terms of the other, and then substitute it into the second equation. Here, quite luckily, one of the variables is already expressed in terms of the other. So, substitute A into 1 over square root of 5 square root of B into square root of B into B into E square root of B, which you get 1 over 5 square root of B E to square root of B times B is equal to E to square root of B. Can I cancel out E to square root of B on both sides? Yes. Why yes? Why is it even a question? Why? What would prevent me from canceling anything out from both sides? Okay, yes. I divide both sides by e to the square root of b. What I have to check when I divide by something is that this something is not zero. Why is e to the square root of b not zero?
It is
b minus 0. Why not? Yes?
Because you cannot raise anything to a power that makes 0.
Exactly. So I cannot raise the number e, 2.7 something something, to any power to make it 0. E to any power is always positive. 2 is to power 0, to negative power, to positive power, always the result is positive. So from here, I can divide both sides by e to square root of b. And so e to square root of b, which is not equal to 0. It's important to mention this, because if you don't mention it, well, whoever will be reading this solution will think either we accept a new value, can cancel it out, or maybe I just didn't think about the fact that it could potentially be 0. So we mentioned that it's not 0, we cancel it out, and we have 1 over 2 square root of b times b is equal to 1. Well, I can write b as square root of b times square root of b, and cancel out the square root of b. Square root of b is 2, and b must be 4. So I want to say that b divided by square root of b is just square root of b. Why? Because b is just square root of b squared. If you multiply square root of b by square root of b, you get b. So here I use that b over square root of b is the same as square root of b. Okay. Alright, so we got that b is equal to 4. We are not done, we still have to find what a is. How do I find what a is? Substitute b into one of these equations, doesn't matter which one. The second one is simpler, the first one should give the same answer. So I'll substitute into the second equation, rise square root of 4, e to square root of 4. And I get an answer which is not as pretty as the previous one. Some answer, 1/4 of e squared. And finally, we should check that b that we got is positive. So we check that the two equations are satisfied, and b, which is 4, is positive. So we check this as well. So now we can give our answer. B is equal to 4, and a is 1/4 of e squared. Once again, the final step when you are solving the problem should be go back to the wording of the problem, check what the question was. Here it was find a and b such that something holds. So the answer should be a is this and b is that. So we give this answer. These questions about this exercise. I want to emphasize a point, well, kind of meta point, not about mathematics, but rather about how to write a solution. It's usually, well, not always, but usually better to have a separation of steps in the solution by, well, two groups steps on the same conceptual level in the solution. So here I first performed the three steps, which were about what kind of conditions should be satisfied by this function to make it differentiable everywhere. what would I have done differently? I could have written one condition and start asking myself, what does it tell me about AMD? So this equation already gives me some information about AMD. I could have started simplifying this right away. I wouldn't have gone too far because there isn't much you can simplify here. But I could have tried. Usually it's not a good idea. Usually you want to ask yourself first the question, kind of high level question. What kind of things I should do to solve this problem? In this case, it is what conditions should be satisfied to make this function differentiable everywhere. And the answer would be functions should be defined, continuous and differentiable, which translates into this, this, and that. Second part will be, well, now you have a conceptually simpler problem than the first one. The first one involved words like continuity, differentiability, functions. If you forget about the wording of the problem and just look at these three conditions, you'll see that this is pure algebra. So we have a second problem which is simpler. Once you have a simpler problem, well, you can solve it, usually using simpler methods. So here it is just algebra. It might be the case that even after this step, you'll have to do some, well, a reduction to even simpler problem and then solve even simpler problem. So some problems involve kind of train of 2, 3, 4 simpler subproblems, but they usually can be simplified. Okay, so once again, any questions about this exercise? So the last 10 minutes today will be devoted to a survey about the past program. So I guess we shouldn't start a long question now. Let's start a couple of shorter questions, two-fold questions. One of the statements is true, the other statement is false, and we'll have to justify, well, to guess which one is true, which one is false, and then justify why they're true or why they're false. So, question one. If one f of x is defined for all x, then square root of f of x is defined for all x, and parallel statement will be if square root of f of x is defined is, I give you two statements. I tell you that one of them is true, the other one is false. I don't tell you which one is true, which one is false. That's your job. And your task is first decide which one of the two statements is true, and then try to justify why the statement is true and why the other statement is false. So to justify that something is true, you usually have to construct an argument which supports the conclusion. To justify why a statement is false, you usually have to just show one counterexample. In this case, it will be one function f of x, for which the premise of the statement is true, but the conclusion is false. So let me give you once again 3 minutes to think for yourself or with your neighbors. you can start asking for him, and then we'll start discussing. If some of you are stuck, let me give you some hint. Think first about the following simple questions. For what values y is logarithm of y defined, and for what values y is square root of y defined? So let me give you another 2 minutes with this hint. Please make up your mind about which one is true and which one is false. And let's take a vote. So who thinks that the statement here is correct? If logarithm is defined, then square root is defined. Who thinks that the statement on the left is correct? If square root is defined, then logarithm is defined. Okay, who has a reason to support their arguments? Or maybe a counterexample to show that the other statement is not correct. Yes?
If that's actually the first one, the counterexample,
if that's actually
the square root of the
factors, maybe
optimized.
Okay. We'll call the logarithm. Was if f of x is minus 4, then square root of f of x is not defined. That's a valid point. That's true. What about the logarithm? Well, in this case, logarithm of f of x will also not be defined. So this will be a case where both logarithm and the square root are not defined. Then I heard another argument. for the square root of something to be defined, this something has to be positive, greater or equal to zero. The more precise technical term is not negative, so it cannot be any negative number. Could be zero, could be positive. When is logarithm of something defined? Okay, greater than zero. So logarithm of something is defined when this something is strictly positive, cannot be negative, cannot be even zero. Okay, so these additional arguments. So I go, let me write this. 1, y is defined for any y which is positive. Square root of y is defined for y which is at least 0. With this additional argument, did anyone want to change their opinion? How many of you, well, now think that this statement is right? And that statement is false? How many of you now think that this statement is right and this statement is false? And most of you are just doubting yourself. I see.
That made me more confused.
Aha. Okay. So where is the difference between the domains and definition of logarithm and square root?
The domain of
long
y is more restricted than the domain of square root of y.
Okay. Which makes which of these two statements correct? The left one. Okay. So the domain of logarithm is smaller than the domain of square root. If y is strictly positive, in particular, it is positive or zero. So if logarithm of something is defined, then this something is strictly positive. In particular, it is at least zero. In particular, square root of this thing is defined. So here we have an argument to support one of the two statements. I mean, for each statement talks about its own function f of x. You could try the same functions f of x to test both left statement and the right statement. That's your choice. You could also choose different things to test. In fact, for the true statement, we'll have to justify the statement for all possible functions f. For the false statement, we'll just have to exhibit one function f of x for which it doesn't work. So there would be, I mean, the statement on the right does not know anything about the existence of the statement on the left. You could as well give it a different thing. It would be still the same statement. But let me see what happens. Okay, so the argument that we had was if one of f of x is defined, then in particular f of x is strictly positive, we cannot take logarithm of a number which is negative or zero. Then f of x is bigger or equal to zero. This might be, well, just slightly confusing, but it is true. If something is strictly positive, in particular it's either positive or zero. And finally, hence, square root of f of x is defined. So this proves the first statement, the one on the left. What about the counterexample for the statement on the right? So the statement on the right is false. Zero. So what will make a good counterexample is any function which is not negative function which satisfies this, but is zero at some points during all such functions. Say again?
Sine cosine.
Sine might be negative at some points.
Oh,
and cosine might be negative at some points. Okay, maybe. Good idea. So counter example. Let me give even simpler counter examples. X squared is always not negative, but at point x equal to 0, it is 0. So f of x is x squared. Square root of f of x is defined everywhere. But logarithm of f of x is not defined at x equal to 0. Okay, so now we'll have to take a survey about the bus program. So this, how is it? Some pages to fill out. Okay.
Doesn't have office hours for you guys. It's fine.
You just get the tutorials.
Yeah.